nice to be here. Can you hear me all okay? Pretty well? Should I, no? Can you hear me? A little bit better? All right. So it's really nice to be here for a lot of different reasons. As Zach mentioned, I teach and I do research at Stanford in the business school. And one of the classes that I teach most recently is around designing AI to fuel human well-being, and certainly physical human well-being as well as emotional well-being is a big part of what you're unlocking, not just with your clients, but also in this movement that you've created. It's really exciting. I was telling Zach that I cannot wait to leave our system and join what you have started to create. So it's really exciting to be here. Another reason it's exciting to be here is that I never wanted to actually be a marketing professor. I didn't really like marketing. I still don't like marketing, which is unfortunate because I am a marketing professor. I'm still kind of like denying it. But I always wanted to be an oncologist. I always felt that raise your hand if you've been touched directly or indirectly from cancer. Probably most all of us. And certainly I was no exception. And my grandfather died of cancer, and my mom spent a lot of her life, and still does, working for hospice and Meals on Wheels and American Cancer. And so I always wanted to make a dent in cancer, but I didn't become an oncologist. And that's partly because I couldn't imagine how I was gonna be this great, hopefully great mom and a great partner, and also be able to pull that off. So I just didn't go that route. And instead, I went the route of an academic. I had seen my dad be a great academic and an incredible dad and partner and everything, and so I went that way too. And it was aligned with my skills, which were highly quantitative, but it allowed me to kind of think about my life in a way that I thought I could achieve multiple goals. So as a result, fast forward about 20 years, I ended up writing a book called The Dragonfly Effect, which is how do you harness the power of story and social movements to make change in the world. And in that process, we were able to work, my husband and I worked with about 17 families who had kids with leukemia to try and find a bone marrow match in the registry for them or get more people in the bone marrow registry in order to find a match because that was sort of the essence of the beginning of that book. And that experience led to 113,000 people in the bone marrow registry and had a striking effect on me, and the reason we were as effective as we were was simply because of the power of story. So I'm really excited to be here today. I'm going to talk about some of our goals. One of the goals is for you all to feel a little bit easier about the way in which you unlock stories in your own life, that stories with data are tools of power. The second goal is to identify your signature stories, which I'll define in a little bit. There's three I'll talk about. And then also to be able to harness story to move people to action, because that is, in fact, what you're doing, which is creating this movement, which is so exciting. So what we're going to do is I'll dive into a little bit of the science of story and unpack why it's so important. And then I'll go into some of the misperceptions of story, dive into how to harness story, and then we'll talk a little bit about what I hope you guys do on Monday. I'll start with some of my research. So I do a lot of research around the area of happiness and meaning and how the meaning of happiness shifts in really systematic ways over our life course. So what this particular slide is 12 million data points, which are combed from the blogosphere. The data set's called We Feel Fine. It's collected by my co-author, Sep Kumar, and his partner, Jonathan Harris. And what Sep did was he wrote an algorithm that combed the blogosphere for all mentions of I feel and I am feeling. And so the way to read this slide, which again is 12 million data points worldwide, so it's English-speaking blog, so it's a little bit biased, but it's pretty robust across global environment. So we start out simple. So these are 11 to 14-year-olds, because blog-based data has demographics you can scrape from. And so raise your hand if you have an 11 to 14-year-old or no. So when you say, like, how was your day? They say, what did you do today? Nothing. All day, you did nothing. You've been gone for 12 hours, and nothing happened. So they don't have this big, rich emotional lexicon associated with them. But we soon fill up with angst. Around 15 to 18, they feel incredibly angsty. When they do feel happiness, it's equated to excitement, which, again, is a very angsty form of happiness. And then feelings of confinement around 20, they start to feel not known. They don't know themselves. Others don't know them. So it's a very lonely time. Until we leave those feelings behind to go conquer the world, around 25, they start to feel like they can start to demonstrate their strengths and passions, that potentially the power of status or money or power itself might, in fact, correlate with happiness. Before gradually trading ambition for balance around 30, they start to realize they've gone too far astray, they're not balanced, they need to get balance back in their life. Developing an appreciation for a body, so at 35, they wake up and they realize their body have gone downhill. It's a big surprise, and then they realize they have to get in shape and start working out. And then they're only as happy as their least happy child, around 35. An evolving sense of connectedness, for which we feel grateful, happy, calm, and blessed. And so the migration of the meaning of happiness shifts in these really systematic ways every 5 or 10 years. And there's a couple of reasons why I share this data set with you. We have a couple of papers that you can get from our website that talk about how we make choices in really different ways based on our meaning of happiness. And so it also suggests that as you think about your own life or your client's life, as they migrate from emotional well-being to physical well-being to understanding what does well-being mean for their family and friends, why they're coming to you or why what they need, it will shift in these really systematic ways. And the other reason I share this is because I often share this large data set with my students just so that they understand that data scientists are, in fact, storytellers, that the only role of a data scientist is to understand large data sets and understand the story of the data that's being told. And so in a very large data set, like the We Feel Fine one, you start to see this story arc, the story of our lives. The second reason I'm actually really excited to talk to you about this topic are these global trends that we see right now. You see digital transformation now being normal. A lot of companies, not just in healthcare, but obviously across industries, are starting to grapple with what does this mean for our jobs, our work, and what we're doing with our time. And the transformation is significant. There's certainly vast amounts of data, more than we've ever had before, and contextualized against that is the fact that the trust gap is significant. There's one large data set that shows that I think it's 58% of people in the United States would trust a stranger more than their boss. We're living in a time, and it's not just distrust for like the financial industry. It's also distrust for nonprofits and even in the medical industry. But what we do trust is we trust, who do we trust? Pharmacists know what they're doing. But we also, we trust people, right? We Google things, we Yelp things, we trust people who we know, whose story we believe in. So it's in that context of all of this mass disruption that you ask yourself, how do I lead as a person and also as a doctor or in the health field more generally? And the contention here, of course, is story. A few quotes that I like a lot. General Stanley McChrystal once said, the story, the why you're doing what you're doing, acts as the ultimate heuristic for rapid decision making. It gives leaders and teams the ability to do the right thing and also to know what the right thing is at the moment. Like, why am I doing it? A second quote I love is by Ben Horowitz at Andreessen Horowitz, the venture capital company on Sand Hill, one of many. And he writes, the company story is the company strategy. The story must explain why you exist, why we're doing this, why should you join us, why should you invest in us. And I emphasize to CEOs that you have to have the story in the minds of employees. It's hard to memorize objectives, but it's easy to remember a story. And as you start to think about what your story is and why you're running the business in different ways, you want to be able to codify and capture that. And Richard Branson, who says, sharing a story or just listening to a story is one of the best ways we have of coming up with new ideas or feeling connected to others. So I wanted to give you a little bit insight, just a quick bit of insight into the science of story. So some background. Because I was trained as a data scientist, you're literally trained to disregard story. So, that's you get your PhD, and what you learn is never pay attention to story. You know, you have a large data set, and then you'll collect another one, and you'll test hypotheses. And so I find it highly ironic that I'm up here preaching this idea of story. And one of the reasons is because in this story that happened to me and my family, which was captured in this dragonfly effect, one of my students at the end of a class, I was teaching on creativity and innovation, didn't tell me what he learned from the class, just a set of bullets. He just shared a story of how the class and some of the learning transformed him. And that story, which he shared with me like in a 40-slide deck, almost like a movie, about his best friend, Samir, who had leukemia at the beginning of the class, and how he didn't have a match in the bone marrow registry, and how Robert, my student, used some of the tools around creativity and story and reversing the rules because doctors couldn't find a match for Samir. And so Robert had to find a match for Samir. And it was through the power of story and harnessing technology that he was able to find a perfect match in 11 weeks for his best friend. And that story completely changed my life because that night I went home to my husband and I said, social technology has something going for it. And the power of story has something going for it. And that sort of led to a series of events that really changed not just how I teach, but also how I research, definitely how I parent, and how I make decisions in our life. And if we have time at the end, I'll talk about a few of those so you can go home and sort of think about what it means for you. In the interim, let me share with you a little bit about the science of story. Once upon a time, information was scarce. So we made decisions based on the advice of experts, using them as North Stars for insights. Now, thanks to the internet, we can ourselves try and find our own answers to questions that plague us and find information to make informed decisions. But instead of finding clear answers, we often find noise. We're living in a world where we have too much information. And because of that, we're even more susceptible to great story. It's what helps us decide what to believe in. Stories are important because they're meaningful, and they're meaningful because they're memorable, impactful, and they personally connect. First, let's talk about memorability. Eugene O'Kelly was a CEO of a consulting company. He started having headaches. He was referred to a top neurosurgeon in New York, where he was diagnosed with late-stage brain cancer, and he was given 3 months to live. He started talking to his wife, how does he want to spend those 100 days? He was purposeful about who he spent time with and what stories to share with them. He also thought hard about what would be remembered in those last 100 days. He and his wife would live each day with a focus on finding perfect moments where time expands and when noise is separated from signal. All that exists is that single moment. And he found in those perfect moments, those were the most memorable stories that defined his life. In one study, researchers asked students to make a 1-minute persuasive pitch to other members in their class. And on average, a typical student used 2.5 statistics in their pitch. Only 1 in 10 told a story. 10 minutes later, the researcher asked everyone to pull out a sheet of paper and write down every single idea they remembered. Only 5% remembered any statistic. 63% of the students remembered the story. Stories are memorable in a way that statistics aren't. Now let me talk about impact. Research shows that individuals are more likely to buy from a person or an organization whose story they believe in and which resonates with them. In one study, Deb Small at the University of Pennsylvania and her colleagues wanted to determine how to best raise money for Save the Children, a charity focused on the well-being of children worldwide. They created 2 versions of a marketing pamphlet. The first version featured statistics about the magnitude of problems facing children in Africa. The second version also featured those statistics, but in addition provided information about Rokia, a 7-year-old girl from Mali, who
who face the threat of severe hunger. The subjects were given $5 as compensation for the study, and before leaving, the researchers asked if they wanted to donate any money to the cause. The individuals in the story condition gave nearly twice as much money as those in the statistics condition. We used to think it was our rational brain that makes decisions. Now we know it's emotion driving decisions, and we rationalize the decision afterwards. Finally, I want to talk about personal connection. Research shows that if we present statistics to an audience, a certain part of the brain called the Broca's and Wernicke's area gets activated. So the language processing part of the brain is activated and we can understand but not feel. When a story is shared, the audience feels the story. Our whole brain is activated and meaning is extracted. The meaning of the story comes from the personal connection the audience feels when they're listening to the story. And when a story is well told, they're able to feel connected not just to the story, but to the storyteller. When most of us think of advocating for ideas, we go to statistics, we go to convincing arguments, facts, and figures, but studies show that if we share a story, people are more likely to remember the message, be persuaded by it, feel personally connected to it. And when data and stories are used together, audiences are moved both intellectually and emotionally. For lasting effect, you need to persuade the rational brain, but also resonate with the emotional brain. Recent behavioral research has shown why stories are so powerful. It's because they're meaningful. Those who tell the best stories will become the best leaders. If we consider the simple question, what is the story or why am I doing this? We may find we make very different choices of how we spend our time. Isabel Allende once wrote, "Silence before being born, silence after death. Life is nothing but noise between those two unfathomable silences." But there is signal and there is noise. And how do we reduce the noise? Story.
All right. Thank you. Thank you. I bet you were clapping over there too. I don't know, just shout out. Was there anything surprising or interesting about that body of work? Someone with a loud voice. What?
Pretty intuitive.
It's pretty intuitive, okay. So it's surprising that it's so intuitive. Oh, I like that. There's a good juxtaposition.
It's not surprising.
Yes. Intuitive.
It's obvious.
Yes. Got it. Obvious to you. Do you use stories a lot?
Yes.
Yes. And then how do you use stories and data together? Okay, good. Well, I'm going to ask you a question in a second. Other insights? Somewhere over here? Oh, over there. Yeah. Yeah, so one background, it is interesting. Like some people that are very natural to story or that use it a lot, might find that also like something that they do more generally, but other times data scientists don't even sort of think about that and are struck by this idea that that was in many ways the most salient thing. A little background, so for this little, I don't know, 4-minute video, it was for a conference, and so I went into the studio to tape it, and they just said, we want to have a bunch of research around story. So I just, shared 2 hours of data. And at the end, I shared this, I shared that Chasing Daylight story. I don't know if you've read this book, Chasing Daylight, but that was about the KPMG CEO. And so it was so fascinating because the way that they cut it together, they grabbed that at the end, they put it at the start, and then they sliced in 3 data points and ended with the point of view captured in a quote. And I never really understood why they would do that in that order. Because I kind of like you, I'll use all these different tools, but not really necessarily sequenced in a certain way. But neurologically, what happens is when you lead with story, it completely transforms the way you actually encode the subsequent data. And so when you lead with story, neurologically, both hemispheres are activated, and so you're actually processing information from a sort of a verbal perspective, but also doing it from an emotional perspective. And what that means is that you have a heightened retention of not just the story, but also the subsequent data, versus when you lead with all this data and maybe throw it away at the end of the story, it's not encoded over time. So there's a lot of really interesting things that come from it. What I find is that with my students, they don't even really understand what is the definition of story. So I oftentimes start there, and we'll define it as a narrative with a beginning, a middle, and an end. It sort of has these arcs, and you go kind of take people up and then down. It's not just a set of, you know, facts or features or data. It's actually a story. So when you're sharing the story, what you're doing is you're taking people on, you know, a roller coaster, so to speak. So you kind of think about, you know, you go think about roller coasters, and you think about movies that you've seen. So for example, James Bond, the arc there is, wow, what happened? I don't know, he gets the girl. And pretty much every single James Bond film has the exact same arc, and we go to it again and again. So as long as you have this arc, you know, you're staying intrigued. Or Jurassic Park, which has this arc. So these arcs don't have to be sophisticated. They just have to have some sort of arc to them. Or Casablanca, a classic movie that has these sort of micro stories that are embedded into the overall arc of the movie. But there's these significant misperceptions of story. One of them is this one we just referred to, that story is not necessarily data. And that's not really the way to think about story. In fact, the first slide I just showed you is where large data sets are actually analyzed and they tell a story. So understanding that story and data kind of go hand in hand. In fact, data scientists are, in fact, storytellers is one really useful way of thinking about why this myth is wrong. But another one is that anytime you're a doctor or a leader or a parent or a friend, you're oftentimes in places where you have your own point of view, and then you have all of this data, and then you have all of these stories, yourself, your clients, other doctors, et cetera. And the question is, what will you lean into, and how will you order it? So in some cases, you'll find that, actually, just a quick raise of hands. There's other contortions, but let's say you have 1 minute with a patient. How many of you would lead with your point of view or recommendation, then you'd back it up with data, and then possibly end with story? Raise your hand, if that's your natural proclivity. All right, so like a few of you. How many of you would probably lead with your point of view, sort of support it with a story, and then back that up with data? A few more of you. How many of you sort of hook with story or share a story, back it up with data, and then end with your point of view? Okay, a lot more of you. And how many of you lead with data and then back it up with story and end with your point of view? Okay, a few of you. So by and large, in the far left. And by the way, like, you might have different contortions. Like, for example, at Genentech, they always say, like, well, where's data, data, data? We have zero stories and zero point of view, just data. So different people have different things. But what's powerful about this is that when you indeed lead with story, it subsequently impacts how you process following information. Another way to think about this is that in some contexts, you'll lean into the story. And in other contexts, you'll lean into the data. So you're constantly trying to sort of understand the audience in which you find yourself, and then you understand how much of the two. And just understanding this idea that context matters, and so it depends if you're at a research review committee, a town hall, a one-on-one with a patient or a client. All of these contexts, as you take inventory of them in your life, you'll find that you'll, you know, lean into one versus the other. The second is that most people believe that stories are these long, epic things. It'll take a long time to actually write it down or codify or capture it. But in fact, Ernest Hemingway was once known to have written the first six-word story. He wrote, "Baby shoes for sale, never worn." So we don't know if that's a couple who couldn't have a child or a couple who had a child and the child didn't make it. But we make the inference of one of those two outcomes. So stories where you give people 2 + 2 and they infer the 4, or they infer the 3.9 or 4.1. It's not always accurate, but when you share the story and they make the inference, they feel part of it. They feel connected to you and or the story. So I make my students always write down little six-word stories the first day of class. And I usually do one of two things. I usually say, share with me a story that you've shared before and you love. It's a signature story. You've shared it over and over again, or at least you've written it down. Or the second one is just write a six-word story like Ernest Hemingway. So whenever I do this, all of my students typically share with me their Stanford essays to get into Stanford, because they're so excited to use them again. Because it's the only reason they got into Stanford, because everyone has good grades and everyone, you know, has good test scores. And really the only differentiating factor is the stories that they captured in their essay or that were captured in the recommendation forms. And so I'll share with you at the end like some of the fascinating findings from those things. But the other thing is they're so lazy, they won't write a six-word story. So I often force them to write a six-word story on the first day anyways. And here's a few that they have recently written. Not quite aspiring to be quite. Tonight he packs, tomorrow I pine. Married the wrong girl, fixed it. Getting old, ringtones piss me off. So these aren't all big epic stories, you know, but they usually have some sort of transformation, you know, sort of a before and an after, some sort of transformation in the eyes of the protagonist. So I'm going to have you do the same thing. Just take 30 seconds and write down or tap into your phone just really quickly a six-word story about yourself. And again, one tip is think of sort of before and after. So, and it could be before and after whatever you want. But just think of some sort of change. So 30 seconds, six-word story. Okay, so hopefully finishing up. All right, so what I'm going to do is have you grab a couple of people next to you, and you have a 30 more seconds to just share out your six-word story to two or three people next to you. So get into little small groups of three or four. All right, go. All right, coming on back. If you were, you could tell it's close to cocktail hour. It's very close to cocktail hour. If you heard a great story and you want to volunteer a story that you heard, just point to the person really like surreptitiously. Oh my God, you've been volunteered. Can you stand up, please? Zach, did you volunteer someone? No. Oh, you. Congratulations, you've been volunteered. Can you stand up? Anyone want to volunteer? Anyone? Oh, congratulations. In the brown hair, you get to go. Oh my God, someone back there has been volunteered. Can you stand up? Like force the person to stand up? Great. It'd be nice to have one more person. Oh, thank you. All right, good. All right. I want to make sure we have a female. Do we have a female? Oh, we have one female, thank God. All right. You stand up now. Stand up. All right. All right, anyone else want to volunteer? Anyone else that was epic? Oh, you've been volunteered. Or if you heard a great story. All right, so you've been volunteered too. All right, we've got five or six volunteers, using the term loosely. And if you could just like shout out your name so I can get to know you, and then your six-word story. And then if there's a mic near you, go for it, and if not, I'll just repeat it. So go ahead.
My name is Shane. My story is no more administrators, I'm out.
Fantastic. All right. I think you're on.
Dr. Leta Quarles, Take-Two Health in Boulder, Colorado. They tried to say I couldn't.
Oh, it's beautiful. All right. The nominee of Zach.
My name's Jeremy Smith. I actually wrote this prior on a scholarship application. Time is money. I have neither.
Fantastic. So, and I think in the yellow, would you mind? Or no, someone over here? No? Nope. Nope. All right. Are you sure? Okay. In the back?
My name's Brian. Camped in NYC, went home early.
I hear you on that. That's the worst. I don't know why people camp. Yeah, went home early. Makes sense. Was there one more?
Yeah, so this actually applies to three people in my life that I thought of when I thought of this, and it's my personal story. So I met a friend. It changed my life.
Oh, it's beautiful. All right, round of applause. So first of all, thank you all for sharing that, sharing these different stories. One thing we find is that, you know, in the space of what, that was 2 minutes, you basically heard about 8 or 9 stories. And oftentimes when you share these stories, it's really different than where did I get my degree or who am I or, you know, what roles have I had. When people share a story, oftentimes it shifts the way that people interact with you, how they treat you. We have one study where I asked half of our subjects to share a 6-word story at the beginning of a 1-hour lecture, and the other half, they shared the 6-word story at the end of it. And then we asked them a bunch of behavioral questions, like, do you want to go have cocktails with the person? Do you want to hang out with them? Do you want to work on the team? How productive was your work in this hour that we spent? And this set of individuals that were exposed to the story exercise, which is just, again, 1 or 2 minutes, were considerably higher in terms of their ratings of wanting to work to each other, how productive they were, how much that they actually enjoyed the teamwork that they did, and how much they wanted to spend time with the group afterwards relative to that experimental condition. So when you share a story, it doesn't have to be long or epic. It can just be brief, and it will shift the way people look at you and whether they understand you. So I encourage you to go home and take your time to ask your kids and your friends and your teammates in the office, share a 6-word story. So stories work because they're personal, they're emotional, and they're evocative. And we're neurologically wired to process information in this way that is story sort of worthy. And the last one is just that most people believe that stories are these big epic things that you share about yourself, but in fact just listening to a story and saying, tell me more, creates conversations that also shift the dynamic between client and doctor, or in fact when you're talking about, in fact, what is happening here. All right, so how do you harness story well? And I wanted to talk about these sort of 3 signature stories. Most people believe that stories are tactical, but these signature stories are these more strategic things that actually drive growth, and they're an asset to be managed. So this is actually work with my dad, Dave Aaker, and we wrote a paper called What is Your Signature Story? And we're defining it as intriguing, authentic, involving stories that drive growth by enhancing the leader, the team, the organization. So there's 3 I want to talk to you about so you leave here today at least with a sense of what those 3 might be for you. The first are these stories to lead. The second is these stories of your team or your office. And the third are these stories that are driving growth for you and this movement. So the first one is these stories to lead. One of my favorite CEOs, he argues, Blake McCoskey, the founder of Tom's. Can we all agree also that Tom's shoes are not attractive shoes? They're not attractive shoes. I mean, they're getting better over time, but, you know. Yeah, I know, they're comfortable, and they are getting better. I'm not saying, by the way, no offense, if you love your Tom's shoes, I get it. Because of the story, they actually, when they started out, and the CEO has just done a really remarkable job of this, is that, you know, because the shoe is a very expensive shoe, they're donating half the proceeds to, or the net revenue, a portion of it to a child in a developing country that needs that shoe. And that was certainly on the forefront of the rethinking business models around story. And so, you know, my daughter, who's 13, she almost only wears Tom's shoes, these very unattractive shoes. But it's because she and her friends know the story. There's an element of understanding this larger sort of mission. In this designing for AI to enhance human well-being class that I teach with Fei-Fei Li in the engineering school at Stanford, we talk a lot about this idea of feeling sort of authentic in each of these areas that you work in, and what does that mean for example, healthcare. So Amir Rubin, the CEO of One Medical, recently came into the class, and it was so fascinating because the way he talked about his own personal story and why he left Stanford to go into One Medical, this idea of transforming healthcare and the impact of it and the power of innovation and technology to do that was incredibly personally powerful. But also interesting was how many, so this is like a set of 40 or 45 students, half of them are engineers and computer scientists, and half of them are business school students, and they're coming together to work in teams, and then they say, this is the project I want to work on. And out of the 10 teams, four of them picked healthcare over transportation or automation or financial well-being. It was shocking. Healthcare was so exciting. And part of it was the way in which sort of Amir talked a little bit about it. DJ Patel also came into the class, the former CTO under Obama, and talking about how do you really use big data to really fundamentally shift how we're running businesses and how much we can unlock healthcare more efficiently and elegantly now. And so it was really funny to see inspiring to see how electrified the student groups were in these teams and these topics that they picked, which are up here. So brands often feel manufactured, or companies even feel manufactured, but people do not. And that also sort of underscores this idea of authenticity and knowing why you're doing what you're doing. Another favorite example of that is the Dollar Shave Club. Does anyone use Dollar Shave Club? Okay, so Zach and like one other person. So if you don't know the story, they launched, I guess, I don't know, about maybe 10 years ago. And they had no marketing budget, their startup. And what they wanted to do is say, okay, well, at least we have a CEO who speaks on that authentically, and he could capture why he's doing what he's doing. And so they just created a little video, and they put it on his Facebook page or their Facebook page. No marketing money or anything. They just did it sort of authentically. And I want to show you what they created in case you didn't see it.
Founder of DollarShaveClub.com. What is DollarShaveClub.com? Well, for $1 a month, we send high-quality razors right to your door. Yeah, a dollar. Are the blades any good? No. Our blades are f***ing great. Each razor has stainless steel blades, an aloe vera lubricating strip, and a pivot head. It's so gentle a toddler could use it. And do you like spending $20 a month on brand name razors? 19 go to Roger Federer. I'm good at tennis.
And do you think your razor needs a vibrating handle, a flashlight, a back scratcher, and 10 blades? Your handsome ass grandfather had one blade and polio.
Looking good, pop up!
Stop paying for shave tech you don't need. And stop forgetting to buy your blades every month. Alejandro and I are going to ship them right to you. We're not just selling razors. We're also making new jobs. Alejandro, what were you doing last month?
Not working.
What are you doing now?
Working.
I'm no Vanderbilt, but this train makes hay. So stop forgetting to buy your blades every month and start deciding where you're going to stack all those dollar bills I'm saving you. We are DollarShaveClub.com, and the party is on. I know karate, I know jiu-jitsu, I drive like a gangster when I'm coming to see you. See you, see you, see you. Thank you so much for so many reasons.
One of which is Alejandra is like, my CEO is crazy. But he put her in because, you know, they're a team and they're going to, like, you know, act like a team. And another one is just this idea of having a really disruptive model, which, you know, reminds me very much of what you're doing here in this room and onwards. The other thing that's really interesting, again, remember, no budget, no money for this stuff. And if you look at the growth, just literally based on that one video, a largely fueling growth, in 2014, they were making $65 million in terms of revenue. Then they doubled it the next year. 2016, they got over $200 million. And last year, they sold to Unilever for $1 billion. So the growth there, just with this idea of having, you know, what is our business model, what's our purpose, it doesn't even have to be lofty. It was just very disruptive, and people connected to it. So if you start thinking about the stories that you have personally, or the stories of why, I love the first story, you know, like, I can't remember what it was, like, not going back ever or something, but like, sort of the stories that gave rise to that six-word story, you think about honing, in 60 seconds or whatever it is, your story. And the four ways to think about or calibrate whether it was good is, was there a goal, what's the aha, and all six stories that you just heard all had different sort of goals. The second is, does it feel fresh? Are you grabbing attention? The third is, are people, the audience, engaging authentically? And the fourth is, are you enabling others to act? Do they have sort of their own story, or do they know what to do after you share your story? So those are the four ways you think about whether it was strong. The second type of signature story is this one about actual aligning the team. So we talk a lot about this idea of how do you get alignment so everyone's working on sort of in the same way or a way that's aligned. I've been lucky enough to work with Steph Curry and actually the NBA more generally and over the last 5 or 6 years. And one of the things, actually one of the reasons I started working both with sort of NBA cares and even knowing what Steph does is through his work with Nothing But Nets, which is a nonprofit that he's been working with for, gosh, the last 10 or 15 years. And I remember this was a while ago, but he, you know, I think a lot of people within the NBA, the National Basketball Association, would say, why are you spending time in ways in Tanzania or talking about Nothing But Nets, which is about how do you reduce healthcare costs because certain families get malaria so easily. And so he would spend at least a significant amount of his time outside basketball season doing these types of things. But it was really important for him to create these different teams that were not just, you know, part of the Warriors, for example. And he often says, not just with his family or these nonprofits or even with the Warriors, is that you win as a team when everyone touches the ball. And this idea that it's not just one person, but the entire team, and that everyone has a role on that team, is incredibly powerful. In this class, the AI class that we teach, and also the Rethinking Purpose class, we talk about this sentence, which is, and I know a lot of you are taking pictures. I would definitely take a picture of this slide. I'll give the slides to Zach, and I'm sure we'll be able to share them. But this is a very helpful sentence, that people want to be valued members of a winning team on an inspired mission. And you need every single one of these words working for you. You know, everyone needs to feel valued or respected. They need to feel like they are part of a team. Like, what is that team? And they need to feel winning. And the definition of winning could be more broadly defined than how it has been in your life or your business or in the world in the past. But you need to define what winning is. And even if you're not winning right now, as long as there's a path back to winning or a path back to optimism, then the team will run well. And maybe even most importantly, you need to have that inspired mission, this idea of what is the mission. And so a lot of CEOs, a lot of companies don't really have that captured and codified. And it's one area where all of you, because not just why you got into the field you got into was based on this inspired mission, but also what you're doing and how you're doing it right now is also incredibly inspired. Most companies and leaders aren't always in that position. Adobe, the CEO of Adobe, Shantanu, maybe 5 or 6 years ago, we were in a room with all of his sort of direct reports. And we had the simple ask, what is your goal? What is your inspired mission? And he said, well, it's to hit $5 billion in 5 years. And you could see all, like, a team of 20 people around him, you know, his VP of finance and marketing and HR, et cetera. And all of them sort of like looked depleted, physically kind of not inspired. And he noticed it too, and he immediately changed his answer, and he said it's to really unlock creativity in the world. And you could see the CFO started to like sort of stand up, and he said later that, you know, he couldn't wait to tell his kids about this inspired mission, because you're not gonna go home and say over dinner, we're gonna hit 5 billion in 5 years. You're gonna say we're gonna unlock creativity, and this is how, these are the stories that support it. And certainly the chief marketing officer started to feel more aligned with that mission, right? Because she wasn't feeling directly in line with 5 billion in 5 years, but she absolutely knew her role in unlocking creativity in the world. And they hit 5 billion in 3.5 years afterwards. And a big reason he believes is this idea of codification of the inspired mission. Because when people feel connected to something that's meaningful or purposeful, they'll oftentimes work harder. They'll get sick less frequently. They'll actually be present. They'll have reduced levels of absenteeism. It's really quite remarkable, the physical benefits when people feel personally connected to meaning. So the last thing to sort of think about or remember is, do you, as you're building out your team, to what degree do you feel that people feel connected to something that is purposeful, that is some sort of inspired mission, that they do feel valued or have a sense of autonomy, that they could sort of do what they want or express strengths and passions? Do they feel like their relationships are thriving in the team that you're building out or the office you're in? One of the, I think, top reasons why people leave companies or offices is that they don't respect their boss and or they don't have a friend in the office. And that's the best indicator of thriving relationships. There's also some nice work by Barb Fredrickson, who studies relationships and what makes relationships thrive. And she oftentimes sort of reduces it down to 3 positive interactions to 1 negative one. That's oftentimes a really good calibration of what thriving relationships, like really good relationship is 5 to 1. In fact, one of the best predictors of divorce in a marriage is 1 to 1. Because you give 1 eye roll or just sign of moderate disrespect, and because that's so powerful, you can't get back to thriving relationships unless you have 3 positive ones. So my husband, of course, uses this strategically, and I come back oftentimes, and he's like, yeah, that dinner wasn't good, but oh my God, you look fantastic. Good job mothering. Also, nice job, successfully driving or going camping or something like that. So he'll just go bang, 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 bang. The third and last is this idea of stories to fuel growth. And this, and oftentimes this comes down to your patient stories or your client stories. And obviously, you don't always have the ability to share them because of privacy. But I'll share 1 or 2 examples of how you could think about fueling stories for growth based on these users or these clients. So companies often make the mistake of feeling that they are the hero of the story. It's all about sort of them. But more often than not, your patients or your clients are. And the question is, how do you share those stories in ways that respect privacy and also respect the fact that, you know, oftentimes, you know, you don't know always all your clients. And I'll give you a couple of ways to think about this. Google has been notorious for not actually believing in marketing. You know, you hire a whole bunch of engineers, they're super smart, you unlock them and they go create things, and then when, in fact, these very smart people create products or services and they don't actually take, Google is usually pretty mystified as to why. Like, what do we do? How do we get people to adopt some of our technology? And that was the case with Google Chrome a few years back. So Google Chrome, how many of you guys use Google Chrome as a search engine? A lot of you. But that wasn't the case about 4 or 5 years ago. They were having a really hard time getting adoption rates. So their design challenge was, how do you get people to leave their default search engine and come to Google Chrome? And it turned out that saying how much better Google Chrome is versus other search engines was not doing the trick. So all of these facts and features about Google Chrome weren't nudging customers to start adopting. So one of the employees at Google, who was on the Creative Labs team, Daniel Lee, sort of sketched out in like 4 storyboards, just like, you know, here's how I use Google Chrome. I wanted to show you just a short clip about what that was for him. People crying over there, which is adorable. That 30-second clip, which was Daniel Lee, actually ended up, you know, he was an employee at Google, but people saw him sort of as a user of Google Chrome, and you notice that it wasn't all about Google Chrome, right? That wasn't the hero. It was Daniel Lee being this great dad, and the fact that, you know, he was a great dad makes us all feel shitty about our own parenting because we forgot to do all that. We have to have new kids now. But except for that part, this was highly successful. It led to adoption. They actually ended up using it on the Super Bowl. And it led to 6% adoption rates in 1 week alone based on that. And that was an employee at Google who just storyboarded it out, and the team started kind of crying when he shared it, not dissimilar to two guys over there. And that's what led to just like, you know, 50 grand or something very cheap to create that little mock-up of a video. And that idea of like sharing the user story and making the user the hero of the story oftentimes is easier than you think. I'd like to also spotlight just a really remarkable hospital in Colorado called UC Health. Someone over here was from Boulder, I don't know. Do you guys know UC Health? Yeah, over here. And they've just done a really remarkable job in the last just even few years. And what they aspire to be as a hospital is a global player, but it was incredibly, it's a local hospital. How are you gonna have a global footprint when you're a local hospital? But what they found was that most hospitals were spotlighting maybe doctor stories, but they tended to be very kind of clinical and relatively dry. And what UC Health felt was that their patients had these incredible stories. So all the chief marketing officer and chief innovation officer, all they would do is they'd ask the doctors each day, did you hear any story, you know? And these doctors would be really, you know, happy to share these incredible stories of their patient. So then they would go talk to the patient and say, share with me your story. And some of them were just mind-boggling, and they would ask, you know, would you be willing or would you be interested in having us, you know, share your story? And more often than not, the answer was yes, because these were so meaningful to these people. And so all of the stories that they collected in the subsequent few years were all real, authentic stories. Here's one.
I want you to know that I've dreamed of meeting you for so long. I'm not looking to disrupt your life, nor do I want to open old wounds. But I do want you to know I'm grateful every second for the life you gave me. I know in my heart that letting go must have been the hardest thing you've ever done. And while it may sound strange to hear this from someone you've never known, I desperately want to make you proud. so I promise to never squander this gift. The gift your daughter gave me. I've been trying to find the right words, but there really are none. There's just her heart beating on. And I want nothing more than for you to hear it for yourself.
UC Health, your life, your story.
Oops. So when they started this off, and again, all of these are authentic stories that the patients are really proud of, and they were very meaningful for them. And so within 6 months of launching this, they had 17,000 press mentions. They actually increased in ratings in a very short period of time, and they're starting to get patients from all over the world. And now they have 150 of these stories. All of them are true, emotional. The patients are proud of them. The doctors are proud of them, and they're actually quite real. And again, this bank of stories that they have are really quite remarkable. And all it did was it started with a story ambassador, someone there. In this case, it was this guy named Banny. And Banny just asked the doctors, share with us, you know, a story that happened to you today. And more often than not, this is a really sort of easy task to do. And they collected those stories each day. Some became part print, some video. And at the beginning, it was just him and a videographer. But then they started actually developing a small team. But it was very sort of grassroots at the start. And then they banked these stories. And these best stories became real assets for the company and have proved out these global growth goals. So what do I hope you do on Monday? I'd like you to take just 30 seconds to write down one actionable, like some concrete thing that you might do. So if you're already, for example, collecting stories, you might think, you know, how could I unlock them with six-word stories with my team? Or how might I think of sequencing stories versus data in different contexts? And if you haven't started doing that, you might just think about other kind of concrete tools that you could do, even with your family, in order to do this. By the way, with my family, we have three kids. We now no longer ever talk about what you do today at the dinner table because of the 11-year-old problem. It's soul-sucking, and then our dinners are like 5 minutes. Now we just say, you know, share a story, you know, and one story that happened, kind of like Banny with his doctors, and it's transformed our family. I can't begin to tell you how much more engaged. Our dinners are now 10 minutes. And the quality of the relationship fundamentally shifts because we're not in this default mode of what you do, what are you going to do tomorrow? We share stories. So just take 30 seconds and write down one thing you want to do Monday. All right, so one thing I hope you do is you start banking your assets. In fact, one Stanford student, I think was so inspired by this six-word story exercise that she started banking six-word stories for her entire two-year career at Stanford GSB, and then she just did it in a beautiful talk about it and tried to find through lines or the common denominators that actually were threaded through these, you know, 2 years worth of daily stories that she wrote down. And so if you bank them, you'll find that actually they really not just color the memories of your life, but they impact how you make decisions moving forward. One of my friends has multiple sclerosis, and he's a professor at Stanford, a lecturer at Stanford, and he used to come into the class, the story class, and he would write down all of his signature stories, the most important stories of his life, and there's 17 of them. He's a big partner in McKinsey, incredible leader, and there's 17 stories. And then the students like pick which one they want to hear, and then he'll share these stories. And recently told me he's in a wheelchair now, and it's very hard to sort of move. And he said that his only goal is to have a few more stories in his life. And if you think about it, you know, your life is only your remembered stories. And so I don't know if you think about memorials you've been to. You know, they don't share content about all of the accomplishments. They'll share stories about how the individual made them feel. So this idea of life only being your remembered stories becomes an impactful way of thinking about how you want to make decisions moving forward. And would the decision you're about to make moving forward be story-worthy becomes a very powerful way of making decisions. So as you start to bank your stories, think about the ones that are true, because we're living in this world of distrust right now. These stories that are bold, that are distinct, relevant to different audiences, memorable so they stick over time, and evergreen so they grow in value over time, and they depict something bigger, something that's very meaningful. And what is meaningful for you over your life course will certainly shift in these sort of ways every 5 or 10 years. So I wanted just to end with my favorite quote, which is, tell me the facts and I'll learn, tell me the truth and I'll believe, but tell me a story and it will live in my heart forever. Thank you. Do you want to take a picture? Stop it. I think we're out of time, but if anyone has any questions about this, all of the content, all of our research papers, all of our workbooks, everything is online for free. So you can Google it or feel free to email me if you have any questions. I'll be back there because someone's going to get me a glass of wine. So if you have any questions, feel free to come up and I'll be here for a few minutes. Thank you so much for all of you for having me.